For people that aren't familiar, the myCircadian Clock app can be found on the website myCircadian Clock, and it's basically your crowdsourcing data. You know, people that want to try this time-restricted eating out can try it out and also send their data to you and take pictures of their food so that you can gather data for your clinical study. Yeah. Your study, yeah. So that's kind of a neat thing that people can participate while they're trying this out. Why not contribute to science?
Yeah. I mean, what we realized is even if we get the best funded clinical trial grant from NIH or DOD or any funding source, most of the clinical studies are done with people who live within 20 to 30 miles radius of a clinical center. And so in that way, even if we foresee there will be 5 or 6 clinical trials in this country, there will be only 5 or 6 of those centers and people who are living within that 20 to 30 miles and have time and energy to travel to a clinical center, spend almost half a day in every 2 to 3 months or 2 to 3 weeks, will participate in the study and will see the benefit firsthand. Then we realize that in that way, most clinical trials which are low risk like this one are actually will benefit or will sample a very small fraction of people. Mm-hmm. So that's why we came up with this idea that if we have a study that's approved by our ethics committee and we make sure that we maintain the privacy of people, we don't sell this data, we don't share this data with anybody else, and we give that assurance up front, then we may be able to recruit or enlist participants who are not living within 40 miles, who don't have time to come to a clinical center, but are willing to share their data for science. And they can live anywhere in the world, they can share their data. And in this way, this has been extremely useful because, again, in any clinical trial, if you look at the exclusion criteria, that is such a long exclusion criteria that only 1 in 50 or 1 in 100 who even shows interest in participating, they can participate. But if we take that result and then try to disseminate to the rest of the people, those 49 or 99 people who could not qualify, then how are we expecting that this will be applicable to all of them? So it's kind of a conundrum. So that's why we thought, let's try this way where the only exclusion criteria is if you are below 21 because that's NIH's mandated exclusion criteria. And in this way, not only we can see whom it will benefit, we may also see whom it will not benefit. So we can actually a priori figure out what are the limitations of TRE. And people who don't qualify, for example, shift workers, they're mostly excluded from many clinical studies because of the nature of their work. They cannot come to the clinic at the right time, and this is more relevant to them. So now we have thousands of people who are shift workers and they're trying this. And from them, we are also learning what they can adopt and how they can adopt this TRE into their lifestyle and whether it helps them with alertness being on the job, and whether it helps them to sleep in the weekend and all that stuff. So that way, this has been extremely useful to have this kind of study. And sometimes we even get responses from our users that we had never thought about. So we take that response and say, hey, can we do this animal study and see what is going on? What is the biochemical basis for this? What is the physiological response in animals? Maybe that's how we can address. For example, there are many cases, there are many immune-related disease. And people report that these immune-related diseases improve under time-restricted eating. And that was surprising for us. But then we went back to our animal data and we realized that, yes, we actually see systemic inflammation goes down with time-restricted eating. And that makes sense. If the systemic inflammation goes down, then many immune-related or inflammation-related disease would also go down with time-restricted eating. So there are some examples like this where our human participants tell us their story, and if it is 1 or 2 person, we may not take seriously, but then when it's 4, 5, 10, or 15 people telling us the same kind of story, for example, many IBS patients who have irritable bowel syndrome, who have been going to toilet for 5, 6, 7, 8 times every day, they do TRE and then they immediately see that the number of times they go to the bathroom has gone down. It's a huge improvement for them. And then we might hear this story once or twice, we may not take it seriously, but then if we hear it 5, 6, 7 times, then we start thinking about, okay, let's go back to our animal data, because from all these animals we have collected every tissue that's imaginable, and we have a freezer full of tissues, and then we go back and test what might have changed, what might be changing in the gut, what might be changing in the intestine. Did the microbiome change? Did the interaction between microbiome and the host change? And that helps us to come up with newer hypotheses and do more focused studies. So this has been extremely useful for people to go sign up on the myCircadianClock website and then download the app and share their data and also share their experience.